And talk about something that affects almost everyone at some point, low back pain.
Okay.
This document says a whopping 90% of people will experience it in their lifetime.
Wow.
I know I have.
Yeah, it's incredibly common. Like you said, most people will experience it at some point. It tends to peak between the ages of 45 and 60, but it can affect people of all ages.
So if you're dealing with low back pain, you're definitely not alone.
Right.
And the good news is, for most people, it's temporary. About 90% of cases resolve within 6 weeks. But I see here they make a distinction between mechanical and non-mechanical back pain.
Right.
Why is that distinction so important?
That's a key distinction because it helps us understand what's causing the pain and how to treat it. Think of it this way. If your back pain is like a creaky door hinge, it's probably mechanical. It might be caused by a muscle strain, a herniated disc, or just general wear and tear. But if the pain feels deeper and more persistent, like a toothache that won't go away, that could be a sign of something non-mechanical.
So something else is going on internally. That's kind of scary.
It can be, which is why it's so important to be aware of the red flags. These are symptoms that could indicate a more serious underlying condition, like an infection, cancer, or even a vascular issue.
Okay, let's talk red flags. This document lists quite a few. What are the absolute must-knows, the ones that should send you straight to the doctor?
Well, one of the most serious red flags is Cauda Equina syndrome. It's rare, but it's a medical emergency.
What exactly is Cauda Equina syndrome? I've never even heard of it.
It happens when the nerves at the very bottom of your spinal cord get compressed. It's like a traffic jam of nerves, and it can lead to some pretty serious problems.
So what kind of symptoms should we be looking out for?
The big ones are sudden loss of bladder or bowel control numbness, or tingling in the saddle area, like where you'd sit on a horse, and weakness in your legs. If you experience any of these, it's crucial to get to the emergency room immediately.
Wow, that's really scary. Are there any other red flags we should be aware of?
Definitely unexplained weight loss, especially if you have a history of cancer, is a big one. A persistent fever could indicate an infection. And if your neurological symptoms are getting worse, or if you have severe back pain for the first time after the age of 50, that's a sign to get checked out promptly.
It sounds like our bodies are pretty good at sending us warning signals. It's just a matter of knowing how to listen to them.
That's exactly right. Now, in addition to red flags, there are also yellow flags, which are psychosocial factors that can influence how you experience and cope with pain.
Okay, so these aren't necessarily medical emergencies, but they can still impact your recovery. What are some examples of yellow flags?
One common one is having negative beliefs about pain, like believing that all pain is harmful and should be avoided at all costs.
So if you're constantly afraid of moving because you think it will worsen your pain,
right,
you're less likely to do the things that could actually help you heal.
Exactly. It becomes a vicious cycle. Other yellow flags include prolonged rest, low mood, job dissatisfaction, especially if your job involves a lot of physical activity and lack of social support.
This highlights how interconnected our minds and bodies really are. Addressing these yellow flags can actually make a difference in your physical healing.
Absolutely. It's all about taking a holistic approach to pain management.
Okay, so we've talked about red flags and yellow flags, but what about the actual physical exam? What are doctors looking for when they examine someone with low back pain?
Well, they'll start by simply observing you, looking at your posture, how you walk, and checking for any spinal curvature.
I can see how posture would be important.
Absolutely. Then they'll palpate your spine, feeling for any bony deformities, muscle tenderness, or those pesky trigger points.
Trigger points are those knots in your muscles that can be super painful.
Exactly. They'll also use percussion, basically tapping along your spine to check for fractures or infections.
So they're really trying to pinpoint the source of the pain. And then what about range of motion?
Yes, they'll assess your range of motion in both your spine and extremities to see if any movements are restricted or painful. And they'll also perform a neurological exam to check for any nerve involvement.
So they'll test your reflexes, muscle strength, and sensation in your legs. I've heard of the straight leg raise. What's that all about?
That's a classic test for sciatica. The doctor will lift your leg while you're lying down, and if you feel pain radiating down your leg before it reaches 70 degrees, it's a positive sign for sciatica.
So how does that test actually help diagnose sciatica? What's the connection there?
Well, the sciatic nerve runs from your lower back down your leg, and when it's pinched or irritated, raising your leg can stretch the nerve and cause pain. There are other tests too, like the crossed straight leg raise, where raising one leg causes pain in the opposite leg, another sign of sciatica.
It sounds like they're really trying to get a precise diagnosis. What about imaging tests? Do people with back pain always need x-rays or MRIs?
Not always. Remember, most cases of low back pain are mechanical, and those soft tissue issues won't show up on an x-ray. However, if they suspect something like an infection or cancer, they might order blood tests or even a CT scan or MRI.
So those imaging tests can give them a more detailed look at what's going on inside. Okay, that makes sense. So once they've made a diagnosis, what are the typical treatment options for low back pain?
Well, the good news is that most cases of acute low back pain, meaning pain that's lasted less than 12 weeks, can be effectively managed with conservative measures.
Okay.
No more bed rest for weeks on end. We know that staying active is actually better for your recovery.
So what kind of things can people do to help themselves?
Applying cold or heat can provide temporary relief. Over-the-counter pain relievers like acetaminophen or ibuprofen can also be helpful. And gentle stretching and strengthening exercises can improve your flexibility and core strength.
I like it, cold, heat, pain relievers, and keep moving. It sounds pretty straightforward.
It is for most cases. If the pain is severe, your doctor might prescribe muscle relaxants for a short period. But in general, the focus is on getting you back to your normal activities as quickly and safely as possible.
And what about those cases where the pain doesn't go away, those chronic cases?
If the pain lasts longer than 12 weeks, we consider it chronic. And that's when a multidisciplinary approach is often recommended. This might involve physical therapy, psychological counseling, pain management techniques, and even alternative therapies like acupuncture or massage.
So it's really about addressing all aspects of the pain, physical, emotional, and social.
Exactly. And remember, if you have any of those red flags we talked about earlier, don't hesitate to seek medical attention. It's always better to err on the side of caution.
Great advice.
Thank you.
Well, we've covered a lot of ground today. I don't know about you, but I feel like I've learned so much.
It's fascinating, isn't it? There's always more to learn about these common conditions that affect so many people.
Absolutely. And I think one of the most important takeaways is that there's hope.
Yeah.
Even if you're dealing with chronic pain, there are things you can do to manage it and improve your quality of life.
I completely agree.